improvement in our life, but God's word of death and life that gifts us with eternal life. If you're visiting with us, if you're first-time worshipers, usually our sanctuary is a little warmer, but the automatic thermostat didn't automatically kick in, so my goodness, it's gone up 5 degrees since 7:30, so by the time the service is over, it might actually be comfortable in here. But we're glad you're here. We'll extend a warm welcome to you, and hopefully that'll work. Would you please, as you're visiting, sign a visitor registration card. We would appreciate that. And for all of you, you may sign your registration pads on the pew. We will follow as directed in our green bulletin, and the pink sheets are the announcements. Please read all the announcements. I'm not going to read those for you. I will just highlight some of our prayer concerns for you. First of all, prayers for Janice Rammert. That is the mother-in-law of Art Ringen. She will be having surgery this coming Tuesday, so please remember her in your prayers. Ashley Blitch is home after stay in the hospital. And Diane Carlson had her procedure and is recovering from that. Lori Shuffleman's recovering from a auto accident she had. And Erica Beckley is doctoring also for the Mensa. So we pray for our MRSA, excuse me, pray for all of them and ask them to keep you to keep them in their prayers also. Happy birthday today to Sarah Klinger and Tira Sir, both celebrating birthdays. And let's see, oh yes, here's my story. A gentleman greeted his friend at the door. And as they were walking to the den of their room, he was complaining. He says, you know, my memory is just getting horrible. And he said, for example, what is that flower? Has a beautiful aroma to it, and I can't come up with its name. It starts off as a bud, and then it opens up, and beautiful, delicate petals, and there's even thorns on the stem. But what's the name of that flower? And the guy goes, are you talking about a rose? He goes, that's it, he goes. And then he calls out to his wife and he says, Rose, look who's here. Okay, with that, I invite you to stand and without shaking hands in this flu season, please greet one another. I invite you to turn to page 73 in the front part of your hymnals as we begin our worship. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sin to God our Father, imploring Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. Amen. I said I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess to you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Therefore, we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Most merciful God, you have given your only Son to die for us. Have mercy on us, and for his sake, grant us remission of all our sins. By your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, so that by your grace we may come to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy on us and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To all who believe in his name, he gives power to become the children of God and bestows on them his Holy Spirit. All who believe and are baptized shall be saved. Grant this, O Lord, unto us all. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are able for our opening hymn number 10. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Glory be to God on high. Thank you. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, to you belong all power and glory. Thank you for claiming us as your own. Give us the faith to honor your name, calling upon you in every time of need. This we pray in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated as we hear God's word in Holy Scripture.
The first lesson is from the fifth chapter of Deuteronomy, found on page 150 in the Pew Bible and page 202 in the NIV Children's Bible. Moses recounts how all the Israelites assembled at Mount Sinai to hear God present his commandments. Reading verse 11. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Here ends the reading. Please turn to page 450 in the Pew Bible. Let us read responsively Psalm 8. Page 450. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers. What is man that you are mindful of him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. All sheep and oxen, the birds of the heavens and the fish of the sea. O Lord, our Lord. The second lesson is from the third chapter of Acts, found on page 911 in your Pew Bible and page 1200 in the NIV Children's Bible. Jesus' holy name works not by magic, but through trust or faith, beginning with verse 1. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. Now a man crippled from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. While the beggar held on to Peter and John, all the people were astonished and came running to them in the palace called Solomon's Colonnade. When Peter saw this, he said to them, "Men of Israel, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power or godliness we had made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus. You handed him over to be killed, and you disowned him before Pilate, though he had decided to let him go. You disowned the holy and righteous one, and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has given this complete healing to him, as you all can see. Here ends the reading. Please stand for the singing of the Lenten sentence found on page 78 of the Reclaim Hymnal.
Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 14th chapter. I read from the 12th verse. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. The Gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. I invite the children to come forward for a children's message. Good morning. Hey, you. You. Hello. I'm talking to you. Hello. Buddy. Hey. How come he isn't paying any attention to me? Any ideas? What? How come he isn't paying any attention to me? He's just over there sniffing that post. Huh? You, hey, hey. Hello? I got it. He doesn't know I'm talking to him. That's it. So maybe I need to identify who I'm talking to. Maybe he thinks I'm talking to you guys. I know. I'll identify him. Here it is. Hey, dog! Come here. No, not you. The other dog. Dog, come here. Well, that's not working either. How could I get his attention? How could I make sure he knows I'm talking to him? You could call him by name. Oh, that would work. Except I don't know his name. Now what do I do? Should I find out his name? Would you? Oh, okay. He says his name is Wolf. Rolf? Yeah, his name is Rolf. Okay. Rolf? Oh, hey, that worked. Now I forgot what I wanted you for. Oh, well, I now know that names work in getting one's attention. Because now Rolf knows I'm talking to him. Yeah, so if I use his name, then he knows that's who I'm talking to. Oh, you know what? Names are very important because that's how we can identify. God gave you his name. And he gave you his name because he wants you to be able to call to God in prayer and in praise and in thanksgiving so that you can direct all that to God. Of course, what is the name of God? Well, that's one of them. Did you know so far somebody has put down 208 names of God? The Word, Jesus, God, Yahweh, Jehovah. I mean, go on and on. There's lots of names. The main name, though, that we use, that he gave us, and we use in worship is God, and his name is Father, Son, Holy Spirit. That's the triune holy name of God. However, there are 208 other names of God. And guess what you get today? You get a sheet with 208 names of God. And you can take this and start practicing reading. And you can learn how to read words. There's one big word right in the middle that I want you to learn to read, okay? It's right here in the black. And that's the word that says Jesus, okay? So there, you already know how to read, okay? And thanks for coming up and finding out how important names are. Grace, mercy, peace be unto you from God, from our Father, from our Lord, from our Savior, Jesus the Christ. The Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Well, hearing that, it seems like taking the Lord God's name in vain is serious. But Actually, you already know that. Especially if your name has ever been taken and used in vain. And if not, the odds are increasing that someday your name will be used in vain. I don't know if you recently read in the Argus Leader, the number one complaint that the Federal Trade Commission receives. What issue in 2014 did the Federal Trade Commission receive 2.6 million complaints about? It was identity theft. For 15 years running now, identity theft has topped the list of the number one complaint reported to the agency. And true, identity theft is a serious issue, because if somebody steals your identity, uses it for their own nefarious purposes, you will have to spend long days tracking down loans you never took out, pursuing credit card purchases you never made, and replenishing a drained bank account, because your identity is no longer yours. The hassle of trying to navigate all this paperwork necessary to clear your name is overwhelming. Identity theft ends up freeing up another person to do whatever they want to do with your name. And no, I'm not making a commercial for a purchasing ID theft protection. What I am doing is trying to say that identity theft is what the second commandment is all about. Note, the second commandment is about using God's name. And yes, I will stress that word, using God's name, as in the same manner we talk about being used or being taken advantage of, as in being used and then discarded. And it is therefore that we read that God says, God will not hold him guiltless who uses God's name in vain. Because God gives us his holy name to call upon him in prayer, praise, and thanksgiving. This is what the children's sermon was about. However, we, in our sinful nature, take this gifting of God's name to us as an opportunity to use it. To use God's name for our desires, to use God's name for our chosen ends. And therefore, we are tempted not to use God's name to call upon him, seeking his will for our lives, but instead to use God's name to promote our will, our agenda, that it might be advanced, even if it is in opposition to God's will. Now, when and how do we do this? Whenever we use God's name in a superstitious manner, meaning using God's name in the same manner in which we would summon a genie. We call upon God, yes, but we want God to be our personal genie in life, granting our wishes for our benefit. Oh, Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes-Benz? Oh, and I ask that in Jesus' name, amen. There, we think. Now God has to do it. He's obligated to do it. After all, we used Jesus' name. Are you seeing it? And see, if God doesn't play step and fetching for us and grant all our wishes, wants, and desires, well, we'll just show him. And we'll go elsewhere. Maybe we'll go into witchcraft to see what we can get. When we seize God's name for our own personal desires and benefits, that is identity theft. That is using God's name. However, God does give us his holy name, his name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, so that we might call upon him to gift us as he wills. It is a great gift to be entrusted with God's holy name. For to know the name of God is to know God himself. To know the name of God is to be invited within this holy presence of the triune Godhead in order to receive all that belongs to the Son, so that we might now live not as enemies of God, but as children of God, to be inheritors of God's gracious gifts. Therefore, God gives us his holy name, that we might bear it upon our brows, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, claimed by God in his gracious promise, I am the Lord your God. We are then commanded not to have other gods, nor are we to use God's name in vain purposes, meaning our own short-sighted, myopic desires. Now, all of this God must command. And he must command us not to do it, because he knows we are bound to do it. After all, as we just confessed, we are by nature sinful and unclean. Therefore, we will seek after other gods. We will create idols out of all the good gifts of creation itself. That was last Wednesday's sermon. And now we know that we will use God's name. We will use his name not so that his will be done, but to seek our will being done in life. Therefore, we will, in our very sinful nature, use God's name superstitiously, calling upon him like some divine genie. And we will use God's name to lie. Yes, we'll use God's name to lie. You ever notice what happens when we get caught in a lie? When people no longer take us at our word, they don't believe and trust our word, it's no longer good enough, then we have to resort to using God's name. I swear to God I'm telling the truth. As God is my witness, this is the gospel truth. We watch public figures caught up in a scandal appearing before the media with spouse and family in tow, and they swear, well, I didn't do this. I couldn't do this. God knows I'm innocent. We will, when the need arises, dig deep in our pockets. We will produce God's name and toss it out there in order to be to our advantage. And of course, this is nothing new. This is what we, in our original sin, do with all of God's good gifts. We don't receive them in thanks and praise. We seek to use them, to trade them in for whatever will suit us. And the gift of God's name is a common casualty. Now, if you've been paying attention and going, well, this is all about the second commandment, you might have a question sitting in the back of your mind. Here I am, you're hoping, three-quarters of the way through my sermon. Here I am, deep in the sermon, and you're going, oh, you haven't once mentioned saying things like OMG, or GD, or JC. I got to use abbreviations because of younger people in our midst here. I have not ever mentioned using God's name as an expletive, because in many ways to focus on that draws our attention to smaller matters, and it doesn't really reveal to ourselves the sin that lies so deep within our very nature. Stop and think. If the second commandment were just merely about, well, you got to clean up your language, well, we can do that. After all, if using God's name as an expletive, which is merely a habit, is the problem, well, that's a learned behavior. And you can unlearn a behavior, as have been attested. It takes only 21 days to establish a new habit. I actually have a foolproof method to establish a new habit and to get rid of an old habit in less time. What this would entail is attaching a dog shock collar to your neck. You then give a transmitter to all of your friends, family, and coworkers. And every time you use God's name in an expletive manner, they get to push the button. Voila. I guarantee that in one-third of the time, you will be trained not to use God's name as an expletive. But sin is deeper than mere learned habits that we can break ourselves of. Sin is not really a matter of what goes in our mouth or what comes out of our mouth. Sin is a matter of the heart, the very being of who we are, our makeup and nature. Therefore, as you watch Jesus and you listen to Jesus' teaching, he's avoiding always this superficial view of the commandments. That's what got him in trouble with the Pharisees all the time. He avoids turning the commandments into mere moralisms and cleaning up your act. Jesus always went for the jugular, which of course is attached to the very heart itself. He's going for our sinful, broken, foul, black hearts. And Jesus is not simply looking to clean them up. Jesus is looking to get rid of them. Now, how do you get rid of a heart? The being, the nature. You kill it. You kill it off. I mean, after all, when cardiologists do a heart transplant, they don't set a new heart just alongside the old one. They rip out the old heart and put in a new one. When Jesus, God's Son, is speaking God's word to us, he is, in his word of law, seeking to put us to death so that we can be raised to a new life. See, second commandment's working like all the commandments. When it accuses you, the shaking finger, accuses you of using God's name for your own willful intent, it's not just saying, well, clean up your language. It's trying to end all the shenanigans of our very existence under our nature of being sinful and unclean. So hear this. The reason we have the Ten Commandments given by God, yes, there's that boundary in which he's seeking to preserve our life temporarily in this time, preserve life in this world, but ultimately, he is then proceeding to not just having us exist in this life, trying to be a little better. He is seeking to put us to death. To put to death we who are born into sin. Psalm 51, from my mother's womb, I was a sinner. Psalm 51, I live in iniquity all my life. This is our nature. We are by nature sinful and unclean. We are at rebellion against God. We are at enmity with God. We are stealing from God things like his holy name to use it to our advantage. This is our nature, and God has to point this out, and then his sin has to be directed to us to, of course, announce the judgment. And the judgment upon sin is that you are dust, and to dust you will return. See, God is not after improving your life. He is after ending your old life, the old nature of sin, so that you will be raised to a new life with a glorious body to live in righteousness and purity forever, with the one whose name you bear by his choosing you and placing it upon you. His name, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. So, here now, the good news. The good news is that your sin is forgiven. Specifically today, your sin of always seeking to use God's name in order to preserve some sort of life that might be better for you here and now. Hear the good news of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sin. That in His name, and only in the name of Jesus, might you be gifted with new life, eternal life. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Amen. As we hear God's word proclaimed unto us, we always then know that His word creates faith, a faith that we can confess together. And I think we have a few sixth graders here who are going to lead us today in what we usually do in worship, which is we confess our faith. And they're not going to do the Apostles' Creed, the short one. They're going to do the Nicene Creed, the big one for us. So,
we believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, He rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, He is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one Catholic, holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Thank you. Remember, it's always good in your development to get up in front of people and do things that make you nervous. So we tell you now. But thank you for doing that. Speaking of getting up in front of people and making nervous, Bev, come forward, please. Today is a new member welcome, and we welcome Bev Kerr as the newest member.
First English Lutheran.
So you're going to have to make two steps up here so we can see you. I promised her she doesn't have to say anything. I'm going to tell you about Bev here. Bev has recently moved to Lenox, lives over in the Walson Apartments, Apartment 1. She is currently retired, but she was born in Murray County, that's southwest Minnesota, graduated high school in Westbrook, Minnesota. She married her husband, Al, in 1965. They have three daughters, a son, 12 grandchildren. Al's work as a manager of grain elevators and fertilizer plants took them to various places in Missouri, Nebraska, Montana, and South Dakota. In 1994, they moved to Sioux Falls, where Bev was employed at Jordan Millwork, Diamond Vogel Paints, and Southeastern Behavioral Healthcare. After retiring, she nannied for a family for the next 5 years, while Al managed a convenience store until his health failed and retired in 2003. Al passed away in August of 2009. In 2014, she moved into Walson Apartments. In the past, concerning her involvement with congregations, she has been involved in Circle Bible Studies. She is a Stephen minister, Christ Care groups, worked in the church libraries and other activities of a church. Her hobbies: reading, sewing, quilting, volunteering at the Sanford Hospital, along with spending time with, of course, 12 grandchildren. So we now welcome Bev as the newest partner in ministry here with us at First English Lutheran. Welcome. Thank you. I'm going to have you stand with us. Stand with me at the end. Okay. Now we continue our worship with our offerings and our tithes. While we do so, we will sing hymn 127, You May Remain Seated. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, we pray for the one holy Christian and apostolic church, that in this season of Lent, the church may be brought through death and the disciplines of life to hear your word. Your word, which is Jesus Christ, our life. For this we pray, Lord, in your mercy. We pray for our witness to your care of your people, as you promised to Patriarch Abraham, the boldness to proclaim that Jesus is the true Messiah. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for this assembly, that we might grow in faith as we daily hear your word that creates this faithfulness. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those in government. We pray for those who are serving us through their jobs. We pray for their protection, for their guidance, that they be gifted with the wisdom that they need. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those we know, especially Diane and Erica and Lori and Ashley and Janice, as well as those that are unknown to us who are experiencing illness, whether it be a body, mind, or spirit, or even those who are also journeying through the valley of darkness. We pray that they might know that nothing separates them from the love of God that is revealed to us in Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. It is into your care, merciful Father, we commend all for whom we pray. We trust in your mercy for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 57. You may stand as you are able.